Hello and welcome to AK Soufflé. I'm Andrew Kay, and this is my soufflé, and it's cheesy, and it's full of hot air. And look at him, isn't he gorgeous? The beautiful Adam and the Ants, who was, at that point in time, when I was an art student, Prince Charming, and he was totally charming. But it's a spurious link, really, because today we're going to be talking to someone from Spunglass Theatre about their new show, which is called Princess Charming. So can we get rid of Adam? Not that I want to, because he's lovely. And welcome to the studio, Jessica Cheetham from Spunglass Theatre. Hello, Jessica. Thanks for coming in.
Oh, no worries. Hello.
Now, Princess Charming. It's quite an interesting project. It's a very interesting project because what you're actually doing is addressing how children respond to gender roles,
yeah,
in a sense.
Yeah, exactly that. It's looking to smash apart gender stereotypes for children, and it's something that really is infused throughout their everyday life. Even if you just take a simple example like toys and clothes and think about the kind of gender differences, right through to the way that sort of kind of parents and teachers behave towards them. And then that then filters down into their play and their games and their social interactions.
Did you have toy envy when you were growing up? I mean, did you watch boys and think, I want an action man? I want Meccano. I mean, probably you're too young for these things, aren't you? Meccano.
No, there was a bit of Meccano. I don't think I had toy envy, but I had kind of more this way that boys would play and the way that they were in the playground and the kind of confidence and the way that they took up space and sort of that was more kind of where I would look over. But I think probably you would have described me as a tomboy. When I was at primary school, when I was much more interested in adventure and setting up some sort of adventure club and being the leader of it than
climbing trees and throwing stones,
yeah,
stealing apples.
Yeah.
I think I lived in a different time, but I do remember one of the boys at infant school, who I won't name because he might even watch the show, but I know that he, when we had dressing up, and we had dressing up all the time, it was quite a sort of common part of being at infant school back in the 1960s, he would always want to wear a dress. He loved it. He really enjoyed it. It was great fun. He also liked doing headstands up against the wall when he was wearing a dress, which revealed his knickers. Sorry. If you're watching and you remember me, then you'll probably know that story. I find it fascinating that actually, when I was growing up, teddy bears were the most common denominator in terms of toys for children, and they were sort of genderless, weren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, okay, they were called teddy, but boys and girls both had teddy bears.
Yeah, no judgment would be put onto the boy or girl, you know, we're saying, whereas now you get a lot of directing towards, oh, that this is for boys and this is for girls. And
it's becoming more prominent, isn't it? It's one of those things that you would have hoped by 2017 was moving away.
Yeah.
Actually, but even with things like toys that were science-based, you know, chemistry sets always had boys with glasses on the box, and they were always geared towards that sort of masculine role model.
Yeah, and it does filter in. And the trouble is that as we're developing this show, we're going into primary schools and talking to children about some of their preconceptions, and they will say things like, you know, just mentioned about the science kits being for boys, and you kind of say, if you start to probe it, they don't really, it's a kind of a just because sort of answer. They just are for boys, or, you know, ballet just is for girls.
Do they think it's odd? Or do they think it's normal? I mean, do you think that their conditioning, even in those very early years, mainly at home and nursery, they are conditioned to think that that's the way it should be?
Yeah, they think it's quite normal. We are speaking to quite a few children that want to position themselves in the middle and say, you know, everything's for everybody, and they're quite firm.
What sort of age of children are you talking to?
So they're between 7 and 11. They're that kind of upper end of primary school.
Now, I know a lot of people will be sitting there thinking, what the heavens, going in talking to 7 to 11-year-olds about these issues? I mean, what sort of permissions have you had to seek to do this? Because obviously you must have had to have talked to the, firstly the schools, but then the schools must have talked to the parents about this.
So we're working with an education consultancy that is working across a number of rural Sussex schools, and they've seen that there is a problem with sexist and gender-based bullying, not just of the children, but of the staff. And so what is, it's a world away from Brighton, really. It's kind of a different perception and a different way of looking at the world than what we're used to here.
So you think we're more tolerant and more open to these things in Brighton?
Yeah, definitely, 100%. And I think where you have, you know, more people who understand about kind of calling out certain behaviour and respecting difference, then it creates a more open culture. Whereas if you've got somebody who, because it's a smaller population, they really are the only person there in that school that...
So you've been working mainly in rural schools?
Yeah, mainly in rural schools.
Do you think you'd have had a different response if you'd gone into a large urban conurbation, into South London, say?
That's my assumption. I don't think that all the children would just be totally for equality and, you know, like, there would still be a lot of prejudice and a lot of bias there. But we're particularly going to rural places where they're not having those conversations.
Do you think there'd be a big difference where if you were talking in schools where there was a broader... ethnic demographic?
I think that would definitely be a different conversation. I don't know exactly.
Because different cultures carry very different attitudes towards the way we dress, don't they?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And the roles of men and women within that, or what boys and girls would be expected to do around the house.
Yes.
Like these things are definitely cultural.
Yeah.
Would definitely be different. But yeah, in terms of the... going back to what you're saying about the permissions from the schools, like we've been working alongside the schools. I've met with the head teachers. Letters went out to parents to say that we were going to come in and do some sharing of material from the show and ask the children what they think of it and do some workshops around gender stereotypes.
Now, what are the responses of the children, firstly, to the questions and things, and secondly, to the material you've been showing them?
We've been really purposefully keeping the discussions really open. We've spoken a lot within the group about not leading the children too much, not trying to influence them too much with, kind of going, oh, did you enjoy that? Or did you like that? You know, trying to open questions of more, what do you think it was about? And they have, because it's a cabaret for kids, so they haven't seen this kind of theatre form before as well. So what they've kind of suggested to us, and their feedback's been really interesting and really varied.
I'm passionate about theatre, and one of the things that worries me about modern theatre and young people and their relationship with theatre is that a lot of the time, if I go to a show which has an appeal to a younger audience, the younger audience don't seem to know how to deal with live performance. They're not aware of the fact that there isn't a stop and start button. And that certainly isn't a rewind. Yeah. And you have to commit, and you have to embrace the whole experience, because that's your one chance to do it. Are you finding that the kids are aware of this?
Yeah, I found, if anything, they've been very polite in the schools. It would be interesting when we get into the live shows, when they're there with their families, to see how they interact, because of a cabaret audience, you want them to be a bit naughty and to laugh and to join in and sing along and that kind of stuff. So it's been a challenge to think, children are often told when they go into the theatre, sit still, be quiet, you know, like be polite and well behaved, and we want to kind of tease that. It's an interesting line, isn't it, between just running around and being too rowdy and not engaging.
Well, it's like going to anything adult, and if there's someone in the audience who is a serial heckler, and it gets to the point where actually the serial heckler thinks that they should be on stage, and it spoils it for everybody else.
Yeah.
I mean, my experience of going to see certain shows, I mean, I went to see The Lion King, which is a wonderful show, totally destroyed by a row of children and family in front of me, who were all playing on their little game consoles.
Oh, what a shame.
Well, it's £70 a seat.
You could do that at home.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think it's a shame that people aren't introducing children to all forms of theatre and saying, look at this wonderful thing that we have that you can go to, and it's so magical and it's so special because it's live. It is your one chance. And it's wonderful that, for me, that you're actually going in, as well as the issues involved in the show that you've created, that you're actually talking to children about how they relate to live performance.
Yeah, exactly. And say that, you know, we showed something in a school last week that was, the performer was lip syncing, which is a very traditional sort of cabaret form to a song. And a lot of the children's initial responses were, oh, it's a shame that she wasn't allowed to sing. Maybe she doesn't have a very good voice. Maybe they, this is the
and
solution
so
you come up with. But when you then tease a bit further, they have understood the kind of deeper meaning. Or why might we have decided to do that? Or maybe because she doesn't feel sure, she doesn't have a voice. And they had picked up on the deeper.
Fantastic. We're going to come back to it, and I want to talk more about the content of the show, but at the moment we're going to go to a break. We'll see you after these ads. Hello, and welcome back to AK Soufflé. I'm Andrew Kay. My guest today is Jessica Cheatham. I'm going to say two words to you. These were words that sort of haunted my childhood. One of them, sissy, and tomboy.
Yeah.
They were such negatives. Yeah. They were such negative forces in the life of children. I was a sissy, for sure. And I had a friend called Judith. And there were lots of Judiths, so they weren't who it was. And she was branded being a tomboy because she liked to play with the boys, and that was that. It's not so prevalent now, but I don't think it's gone, has it?
When we're talking to children in schools, tomboy is used. Sissy is not.
Sissy's gone. Well, that's good news, isn't it?
To describe one another, which is really good.
Unfortunately, they've replaced it with gay.
Yeah, which is.
Which is very...
Again, we didn't come up with, because they're quite polite children, but are like...
Nice home counties kids.
Yes.
I think it's interesting as well that that word sissy actually wasn't about sexuality.
Mm.
It was about being soft.
Yeah.
About not being strong, not being butch. And when we come to what you're doing, it isn't actually about sexuality.
No.
But this is about how gender roles are manifested, sort of separately from sexuality.
Exactly that. Yeah, exactly that. But there is a cultural meshing of the two, and that's where it gets quite damaging, I think, for the individual, because, you know, depending on what you're kind of going through. But I think that what we would ultimately be going for is that there isn't a tomboy, that it's just, you know, girls, boys, children, you know, that why is there that distinction to say that if a girl is interested in these certain things, that then you have to be something other than a girl. You have to be this tomboy character. It's just about, you know, kind of embracing everything for everybody.
Now, you've been out there, you've been doing massive amounts of research, working with young people, working with older people, talking about their experiences of things. How have you translated that into a performance piece? And this is a cabaret format show aimed at audiences from?
Well, yeah, 7 to 11 is our kind of main target. Right. It's a family show. They say the director is very much going, I'm going to make the cabaret show that everyone will enjoy. It's just suitable for children. It's PG. Cabaret show. How's that being translated? We've been doing a lot of different feedback, discussion groups with the children in the schools, some written feedback from the children, and that's then going into rehearsals. We've even kind of gone actively with them, and Alex, one of the performers, was getting the children to suggest girl dance moves and boy dance moves, and those dance moves
are
getting...
Are there differences?
Massive differences.
Really?
Yeah. So
I'm not going to ask you to demonstrate, Jessica, because your microphone will pop out.
Yeah.
But, I'm fascinated that there are differences. I think that's probably because the last 40 years I've been going to, well, not in the last 20 years, but for a long time I went to a lot of gay disco, so I wasn't really seeing a lot of girl dance moves, yeah. Only at family weddings, and then they tend to be not great at dancing.
Not great, yeah. So the children were kind of giving an interpretation of girl and boy through movement. So the boys would have a lot of game consoles, dabbing is a very masculine
dabbing.
Act.
What's dabbing?
Act. This is a sort of Usain Bolt footballer celebration.
Was that dabbing?
Yeah. Mm. and the girls are very balletic, very graceful curtsies and pliés and arabesques and those kind of movements.
A lot of boys found it easier to actually be more graceful and more feminine after the film Billy Elliot. Hmm. Which really broke down quite a lot of boundaries for young kids relating to the arts and particularly to ballet. Do you think that's had a really positive impact?
Yeah, definitely. I think that it gave a vocabulary, you know, not just for boys, but for working class boys to embrace something artistic. I don't know what the equivalent would be for these children that we're talking to.
I suppose.
But it's not come up in any way. But maybe we'll suggest it on Thursday when we do our next workshop.
Yeah.
See if they've heard of
him. I would have loved to have done dance classes as a kid. I don't think I'd have been very good at it. But there was a stigma attached to it. Boys didn't go to dance classes. Mm. It was just something you didn't do. But I never wanted to express a sort of feminine me. I think I was just rather gentle rather than aggressive. I never wanted to fight and things like that. Do you think it's important, an important factor of what you're doing is actually instilling a sort of more passive nature, particularly in boys, and saying to them, you don't need to be aggressive to express your personality. And the same for girls, that you don't need to be passive.
Yeah.
You know, you don't have to sit back and take it.
I think that's really interesting what you're saying, like, and it is something that has come up a lot, the difference between passive and active. And in terms of how that then manifests itself in adult life, you know, everything that's coming out at the moment about the sexual harassment and everything, this is what, you know, if you can build up the confidence in boys to express their emotions and to read emotions in others, and in girls to actively hold their own space and stand up for themselves, then as you grow up, these things become a more instinctual within men and women.
Stereotypically, people who go into the arts are thought to be, let's use the kids' terminology, this is gay. There's a perception that actually, you know, if you're an actor, you've got to be gay. Mm. And I think that has gone on for a long, long time. Do you find with the boys that you're talking to that if they are the more passive, the quieter, shyer, and perhaps more bullied, mm-hmm. should we say, mm-hmm. that they will use their skills with humour to fight that? I mean, I know I used to talk my way out of bad situations.
Yeah.
And I think it gave me the ability to blab on a show like this. it gave me that sort of strength of character that I used instead of physical aggression. I would use my tongue to...
Yeah, we're very clever social animals and we will adapt. And if you're not going to fight with brawn, then you can fight with different tools than with wit and humour or sarcasm and
kind of put we like it. We like a bit of sarcasm, don't we?
Yeah.
But sarcasm is a very dangerous weapon because it can backfire so badly.
Yeah.
And how do young children learn how to use those skills, those verbal skills, those mental skills? It's much easier to pick up a stick and hit someone on the head than to actually formulate an argument and fight back with your brain.
Yeah. Definitely. And I think that a lot, going back to the toys, a lot of these skills is what is discovered through play and playing. And if you maybe, you know, as a female are encouraged to do quite quiet and small imaginative games, and, you know, males are encouraged to do boisterous and take up a lot of space.
I find modern toys very prescriptive. They're actually giving you a character. And you know the character because of its video, its game presence, and where it works, and so on and so forth. When I was growing up, games were far more creative. I remember Lego when it was a creative toy, and now Lego is a jigsaw.
Lego comes
with a box with a picture on it of what you've got to make with the things in the kit. When I got it, it was just blocks. And you created yourself. And I find that I'm disappointed when I see toys these days and they're not more creative. I mean, I would want to sort of ban those prescriptive sort of toys and go back to the days where you were given colouring books, not colouring books with drawings in, but plain paper and pencils and crayons and paints, and actually allowed to use your brain to stimulate your creativity. Are you seeing that, you know, the stuff on the shelves is just not very inspiring?
Yeah, and I think it goes all the way through children's lives. That is one of the reasons I'm so passionate about creating workshops and theatre and creative experiences for children, where it doesn't prescribe, this is the experience you're going to have, this is what you're going to think, and, you know, and giving them an opportunity to create. So at the end of Princess Charming, the children are given 15, 20 minutes of free play, so they can come onto stage, they can interact with all the props and the toys that we've got on stage, with the costumes we've got on stage, and we're going to bring out even more stuff. And it's an opportunity because children, they're learning, they're experiencing and formulating their ideas through play. They've seen something, they can act it out, they can try it out.
You open in London in a week's time.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you come down to Brighton to the Marlborough Theatre
at
the beginning of November.
Yeah, 4th of November.
And how easy is it for people to get tickets?
Very easy. If you go onto the Marlborough website, there's a ticket link on there, or you can pop into the pub and you can buy them without the booking fee.
That's fantastic. I think I might have to come along and see it because I just want to play. And I think play is one of the things that we've ruled out of our lives. Real play, real creative play. Thank you, Jessica, so much for coming in to AK Soufflé. And good luck with the show. Thank you for watching AK Soufflé. We'll be back very soon. Good night.